9922. The Ryan line is open.
This lunatic with a very bad haircut showed up on daytime radio and he just injected Ireland with a sense of fun.
We spoke about drinking your own urine. Of course, Gandhi drank his. We've even been known to drink it on the programme.
In 1988, Gerry Ryan made his mark on Irish daytime radio.
Here was a man talking about sex toys or talking about where is the actual G-spot.
Had you libido before?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, plenty of it.
Yes,
here.
In bucketfuls.
And
yes.
Now gone.
Gone and lost forever.
Management thought he was mad and trouble and uncontrollable.
You guys are dodging the bullets here, right? Either you trust men or you don't trust.
Well, you know them.
You would trust a man that you know well.
He knew his audience. He absolutely knew his audience.
You feel better after saying that, do you?
I feel better with it,
yeah. The punters felt it and it responded to it.
I mean, I've three girls, Jerry, and I remember when people said, I hope it's a boy. And I said, God.
Oh, God, just a healthy child is a blessing. Yeah.
He became the king of talk radio and grew a loyal audience.
Jerry was 2FM. He had 3 hours of prime time. That's where the money was made.
When he would order wine, he'd frighten the life out of you.
The bill would be thousands. I'd say, are you mad? What are you doing?
While Jerry's ratings remained strong, off-air, the pressure was taking its toll.
He wasn't happy. He wasn't in a good place.
He could have done with more healthy lifestyle. He liked his rich food and he liked his rich drink.
None of us saw it. He burned and crashed.
The Gerry Ryan Show.
And a very good morning to the entire nation. For the texters, 51552. For you emailers, GLS.
Gerard Patrick Ryan was born in 1956. He grew up in the middle-class suburb of Clontarf on Dublin's north side.
There were three boys. We grew up in Clontarf, Kincor Avenue. Mum was Maureen Burke. She was part of the Burke theatrical family, who certainly, when I was growing up, were very well known.
Showmanship was in the blood. Jerry's mother, a dancer, was related to both Brendan Behan and the author of the national anthem, Pather Carney. Jerry's godfather was the well-known broadcaster, Eamon Andrews. Floodlights and grease paint were familiar to the young Gerry Ryan. Burke's Costumery on Dame Street was his mother's family business, supplying costumes to the Theatre Royal and the Olympia Theatre.
We'd go in regularly. Obviously, you can imagine it was a theatrical environment. There was colour in each particular area. Within each floor, they would have had, you know, 1920s. You know, there would have been 1900s. There would have been Victorian, or whatever it may be. I'm pretty sure that in fact, I know it influenced him, yeah. My father, Vincent Ryan, went into dentistry in the 1940s. And for everything about him that was very science-oriented, he had great humour, really funny man. Jerry and himself were very, very close and got on very well. My father loved cars, and the car was a big investment for him, and he was a dentist, but we certainly were particularly wealthy. But he managed to find enough for his Jag. The big day arrived. You know, leather seats at the time, and Jerry sat in the front, I seem to remember. I think for Jerry, there was a bit of a statement there, and he was very proud of it. He was proud of his dad. Have time for something fine in your life. And I think that was a symbol of that.
Jerry attended St. Paul's College, Raheny, where he became close friends with fellow student Conor Haughey.
Jerry was a year ahead of us, and I was in the same class as his brother Mano. He was a bit different to the normal teenager at the time. We were all interested in normal teenager things, but he knew all about these mad things like Frank Zappa, none of us ever heard of before. About 12, 13 on, we used to all hang around together, and Some weekends, Mano and Jerry would come and stay in our house. Other weekends, myself and my friend would go and stay in their house.
Connor had the pleasure of sleeping in, you know, a 1950s semi-detached house. And our turn to sleep over with Connor was in Abbeville.
Connor's home was a 14-bedroom mansion. It belonged to his father, the then former Minister for Finance, Charles J. Haughey.
Abbeville was a great place for young people. There was a lake there and there used to be pheasant shoots on and a swimming pool.
Of course we said, look, we've got to have a swim. Then we see this figure. This impeccably dressed man who I recognised as Mr. Haughey. And he came over and he said, you know, and who have we got here? And Connor stood up and said, this is Mano and this is Jerry. And he said, yes, I've heard about both of you and I don't want any trouble. But he obviously said it in a way with a glint in his eye. Jerry got to know the Haughey's very well. And I think himself and Charlie had a particular connection. You know, they weren't going off having, you know, tete-a-tetes about the state of the nation, although Jerry may have thought they were. Charlie liked the fine things in life. And I think Jerry really found that fascinating, that this was a figure of such style and charm and connected with ordinary people in a very real way. I think that had a big impact on him.
All teenagers listening who think that life is tough. I had to get up for a 9 o'clock lecture and it was really hard and they've got exams and everything and it's freaking my head out completely.
I first met Jerry Ryan in Trinity College in around 1978-79. He was doing law, I was doing social work, I was doing agitation, he was doing celebration. I was involved in the student union and there was a tradition called the Elizabethan Garden Party and there was people dressed up in Elizabethan outfits and we were protesting outside for kowtowing to British colonial imperialist lackeys and Jerry just shouted an expletive at us and swept on and he loved that word.
Extrovert is the understatement of the year. He was a whirlwind around the place. We had a mutual friend, a guy called Mark Story, who turned out to be one of the big guys in pirate radio. The rooms I was in Trinity College, we'd have a transmitter in there running our own local pirate radio on and off.
At the age of 21, Jerry's life took a new direction when he met a young art student called Maura Brennan.
You met her at a dinner in Colester in the old army cottages and he said they were instantly in love, holding her hand under the table, as you do.
She was very different from anybody I'd ever met before, ever been out with before. And she was just really special. She had a kind of outer worldly quality about her.
She just oozed charisma. And I know, like, he was very, very taken by her. From what I recall, he pursued Maura and it became the big love story.
The connections made at Trinity College were to pay off, and Jerry ventured into the illegal world of pirate radio.
He moved into one of the big Dublin pirates in 1977 or so. That was Big D Radio.
Get turned on to Big D. Jerry was on Big D and I was on Big D at different times and different programs. He wasn't really at night time with me that much, but I mean, I saw Jerry and knew Jerry then. But it was great fun, it really was fantastic. We'll make it worth your while.
In a bid to contend with pirate radio, RTE set up Radio 2. They recruited DJs and radio producers from the pirate stations.
A number of us applied as producers and Mark Story and myself, two Trinity lads, got the gig. And when we moved in, we really insisted on Jerry coming with us. We knew him, not so much as a radio person, but as a performer.
Jerry Ryan.
Are you ready for the good time?
Good.
To be honest, many a broadcaster who shone outside in the pirate radio environment, as soon as he walked into RTE, died a death.
We really wanted to make sure the evenings were directed straight at the under 25.
8 to 10 was me, and then Jerry was 10 to 12, and then Mark Cagney was 12 to 2. And if you like, I was playing the newer and indier stuff and whatever it was. Jerry was just doing anything, 12-inch singles, didn't know what he was doing half the time, and Mark was doing the more kind of proper album-y stuff.
We caught the zeitgeist in terms of what young people wanted, and Nighttime started to do really, really well. And I remember actually the Hot Press at once did call us the pilots of the airwaves. We loved that. We thought that was great.
Well, it was myself, Fanning and Cagney. It was like being in Led Zeppelin, except we didn't get the money. Nobody downstairs in the managerial offices knew what was going on in Nighttime. Nobody.
We were getting paid and having a great laugh. And for about 6 or 7 years, that was really pretty special.
The 2FM DJs took to the stage for the beat on the street. The crowds arrived in their thousands.
They say also that of all the disc jockeys on the beat, that you are the man who is most over the top.
What they mean is that come 10 o'clock, I get up and burn my soul basically for 65 quid.
It was ridiculous. The idea that you would get 20,000 people just to stand and listen to these three bikes playing records.
Oh, a bit sad, really, but did it work? Did it work? I asked somebody who was there. It was great fun, and it was free.
We would do gigs for 500 people, and you could have some interaction with the crowd and others. You can't interact with 20,000 people. Well, we couldn't. Jerry could. I mean, Jerry went, my moment has arrived. Yeah. Young man, in the name of
love. The big thing was always Jerry, and Jerry went mad.
He threw the works at it, absolute flamboyance. People loved it because they could relate to this. And then around the time of the beats on the street, he was getting very high profile. He was brought into this reality show.
Jerry, how do you feel?
Very tired.
I just remember the fallout from it.
In 1987, the Gay Byrne Show ran a survival course where Jerry Ryan and five others were sent to Connemara. Each day, they would phone the radio show to let listeners know how they were surviving.
So every night you're going to be starving and banjaxed without food.
Without
Jerry.
Food.
You're going to die.
We're going to die, possibly. And also, we're not getting...
When we started off the week, Jerry was sort of just thinking, this is all just going to be a bit of crack. He couldn't help himself but to elevate it. I think it was a Wednesday morning. They turned up and they had a lamb... fully butchered, with the head removed, and they were carrying it on a stick. And then Jerry, in the most graphic and elaborate and brilliant storytelling, told this whole thing about how he put a rock in a sock.
Ciarán stunned the lamb with a rock in a sock. And then Cathy stabbed the lamb in the throat, and at that stage, I think it was as close to dead as we could get it. So then we hung the animal and skinned the animal and gutted it, and we have it now prepared, and we're going to eat it sometime today.
The next day, all hell broke loose. Jerry had gone from a DJ that not many people had known to front page news. And then Tony Gregory brought it up in the Dáil and said that we breached the Broadcasting Act because we incited violence to animals. And I thought, God, this is actually getting quite serious now. I can't believe this has happened.
And they finally made it back to Dublin in dishevelled state, and let's say hello to them. Jerry Ryan leads it, ladies and gentlemen.
The killing of the lamb caused such public outrage that a Garda investigation was launched to establish how exactly the lamb was killed. Jerry was summoned to Donnybrook Garda station to give a statement.
Did you skin the lamb?
No, I didn't personally.
Did your co-traveller skin the lamb?
I'm not really prepared to say at this stage what. Mr. Philip Kemp.
You were the producer of the programme, and now the public are puzzled. Did you con the public?
News television crew arrived into the radio building, and I intercepted them coming down the corridor, and I said, no. He's working. This is a working area. You have no fucking business being in here at all. And that was the level it was at.
Eventually, the truth about the lamb's death was revealed in the Dáil by the Minister for Justice.
Following guard investigations, the killing of the lamb was not as stated on the programme. The statement was backed up by a farmer in Connemara. He fed the survivalists.
I got a shotgun, I shot the lamb. The lamb was dead immediately.
How I found out the first time was Kathy. I knew her very well. We went on a date to Dublin Zoo, right? And we were walking around Dublin Zoo, and she says, I've something to tell you. From that point on, I actually just stayed miles away from Jerry, really for about 17 years.
You didn't hit the lamb over the head with a rock and the sock?
No.
Right, major inquiries.
I was really convinced at the time that I was a goner. And I must say that RTE took a very humane stance on the whole thing. I think that would be the best way to describe it.
They let you stay?
They let me stay.
Jerry managed to survive Lambo and was now a household name. When a morning talk show was introduced to the schedule, RTE decided to take a big risk and put Jerry Ryan onto morning radio. It was a decision that would prove to have an impact few people expected.
RTE needed somebody to shake up its morning schedule, and Jerry was a risk.
He'd come with the whole Lambo reputation, so people were a little bit kind of, you know, he's a bit cheeky.
The idea was horrendous to a lot of people. The reality was far worse, because it really was. Oh.
Having survived the Lambo controversy, the powers within RTE took a risk and moved Jerry Ryan out of late-night radio and onto the biggest show on 2FM.
I was really lucky. I was at a time, there was a guy called Bill O'Donovan who was the head of 2FM, and Bill just basically believed. And I said, well, what should we do? And he said, you just do whatever comes into your head, you're in charge.
And I said, so why don't we put Jerry Ryan off at 10 o'clock tomorrow? And he said, but he's mad. And I said, that's the idea.
The Jerry Ryan Show, Monday to Friday, 9 till 12 on 2FM.
In March 1988, the Ryan line was open for the first time.
His opening, I just got, oh my God, yeah, this is serious. Please be okay.
3 minutes past 9 o'clock, the Ryan line is open. You can contact us with your comments.
We were all scared. I know my mother was scared.
Your sorrows, your joys, and double.
I was so delighted that it went well. And then I remember ringing my mum, and it, you know, she was crying, because she was just relieved, and she was delighted that her son was now really on the national airways.
Let's be honest, the shows weren't great. It took a couple of years for us to find out what part of his character the public liked.
Yeah, well, you're going to end up in a 5 Series BMW with a cashmere coat and a business suit as well, aren't you?
Remember, it was 3 hours long. You really had to give him a lot of control of the show. He effectively was a producer on the show, deciding what we'd talk about and taking us to strange places that RTÉ had never gone before.
Her lads in her class say your mum's a milf.
You know what it means. It's a mum I'd like to...
Female,
this is a complete fudge.
You know.
This
how
is
many?
A complete fudge. Why don't you just call it? They sell more vibrators in the United Kingdom than dishwashers.
There are recipes existing for the cooking of human beings.
Is there really?
I'm looking at a picture of your bottom on page 6. I mean, it doesn't look that big to me.
Thanks very much.
People would say he was Ireland's first shock jock. It was very different to anybody else. Really, like, just clutch stupid stories out of the sky.
Sexual things, outrageous things, bad language, stupid stuff.
Have you lost your libido? Experts now claim that eating certain foods can enhance your sex drive and even improve sperm count. My God, get me a packet of this.
He was so intelligent. He had an ability to grasp so many different topics. He could have a farmer on looking for a Filipino bride in one beat, and then the next beat, he could do a very complicated, detailed, in-depth interview.
I worked in a beef hatchery down on myself, and I seen an awful lot things going on that was really outlandish and disgraceful.
Did you ever make an official complaint to the management?
No. You might never get a job again anywhere if you got out who you
want. People can identify with somebody talking about that kind of thing, but it needs to be good, and it needs to be entertaining, and it just needs to really hit home. With Jerry, it was always good. It was always entertaining, and it always hit home.
Good morning, everybody. This is Century Radio.
In 1989, broadcasting licenses were awarded to independent commercial radio stations. Jerry soon realised there were deals to broker and money to be made.
Now, it says in the Irish press today, you're ready to be poached, you're dissatisfied with RTE.
Well, of course, you know, you don't believe everything you read in the papers. So, yeah, I haven't signed my contract yet.
Oh, let that be a warning to those out there that we all know.
Once Sirius Commercial Radio came in, they had checkbooks, big checkbooks. But he was thinking of security and he thought that if he left RTE, he'd never get a chance at television, he'd be cast out into the darkness. And he said, do you know what? No. And he did dance with them for a little bit. There was a bit of a courtship. He said, no, but you know what? Maybe you should talk to Cagney. So I have him to thank for getting me out of RTE. Shortly after that, I think Jerry would have got the first of his big contracts. You're unbelievable.
Jerry had established his own particular style with a tight and loyal production team. They were attracting a growing listenership with their unique approach.
Even though he might have been very tempted to go, he actually was very loyal to RTE. He loved the people he worked with.
I'm often asked, you know, what I attribute my success to, and I think it isn't just Jerry Ryan, it is a bunch of individuals who are particularly underpaid, very dedicated, and God love them, very, very naive.
Unlike other radio broadcasters, Jerry often spoke of his personal and family life on the radio. Never more so than when he became a dad.
I remember Lottie, like, when she arrived, she became the centre of his thinking and his life. Well, of course, it was fantastic because it gave him another line of stories. So, huge material.
Mrs. Ryan and Mr. Ryan love liver.
I mean, you also like cigars, but you don't make your children smoke them. Or do you, Jerry Ryan?
No, I don't make my children smoke cigars, though the lads would at the drop of a hat. The girls think that Dad and his cigars are horrible, and it's horrible. He's smoking again. He's drinking that brown.
Well, we've managed.
Jerry's children were up there, and literally everything else was on the floor as far as he was concerned. He adored those kids. His five children were just his life.
You know, he might give out about sleepless nights and, you know, all the usual issues that everybody does, but any calls that would come in, you could be in the middle of a meeting, one of them would ring about something in school, bang, forget the meeting, he's gone.
Bear with me now as I quote from the front page of today's Star newspaper. The headline: Anger as a young rapist is allowed to walk free.
The show was going quite well and getting a little bit of traction. It was a bit supercilious. And then one day a phone call came through, and that in many ways was the pivot which changed the show.
Hello, hello, Jerry.
Hi, how are you? Now, what do you want me to refer to you as? What, do you want to use your own name or do you want to use another name?
Yes, please, I'll use my name.
What is your name?
Lavinia.
Lavinia.
He was acknowledging that I was his human. You know, I wasn't introduced as a rape victim. He just said, and what's your name?
Lavinia Kerwick was the first woman to waive her right to anonymity after the man convicted of raping her was given a suspended sentence.
Now, Lavinia, can I ask you, how old are you?
I was 19 a few weeks ago.
It's right. Just me and him talking about rape.
He raped me not just once, but several times, and beat me up.
And him giving me the opportunity to kind of talk about the brutality of a rape, which was a first for a national airwaves.
Not only are my sympathies with you, but I think anybody listening this morning will sympathise 100% with your situation.
He had a great listening ability, and he strongly became my wingman after that.
The 19-year-old Kilkenny girl arrived at the offices of the Department of Justice at 6:30 this evening. On her way in, she said she was going to tell the Minister for Justice, Mr. Flynn, her side of the story.
On the back of that interview with Jerry, the judicial system couldn't stand back then and do nothing.
He threatened me.
Lavinia's interview on The Jerry Ryan Show directly led to the introduction of victim impact statements in court and allowed for the appeal of lenient sentences in sex crimes cases.
Those laws are there now. Nobody can take them away from Jerry or me. They are set in stone forever.
I think I've done some television programs that, you know, that I just shouldn't have been involved in. Just because you can do something doesn't necessarily mean that you should do it. Now, that took me a long time to figure out. I'm a scat man.
Soon after moving to daytime radio, Jerry moved into primetime television. The transition was not an easy one.
He was given vehicles that didn't really suit him. What he himself referred to as shite programmes. Like Secrets, Jerry very naively thought that he could bring elevated level of showbiz into very small sets and very small worlds, and it just didn't work.
Who says that we haven't got one of the finest national herds in the world?
I think because he was a performer. You know, he lived and died by the applause of the crowd, you know, that it did actually affect him. He always liked to do well. He liked everyone telling him he was great. He's no different than anybody else, but he liked it in a larger-than-life way.
Now, do you have problems with your curly-whirly?
The programmes were all really quite daft and mad and zany, as Jerry was meant to be.
Or maybe your entire life is totally controlled.
I would have thought that a lack of homework would probably not be the greatest way to be doing these big television programmes.
Big girls, big boys, superstar DJs, here we go!
In 1994, Eurovision came to Dublin's Point Depot. It was to bring Jerry to the biggest audience of his career with over 200 million viewers.
I've had this recurring nightmare, just as we come on stage, that I fall over.
But I'll be there to pick him up.
She'll be there to pick. That's what she's here for.
Yeah,
to pick
that's what I'm there for.
The Eurovision thing was huge for Jerry, and he started getting quite serious about it. And I remember we went out for a meal, the four of us, and myself and Ursula and Maura came in and we sat down, and Jerry came in about 3 minutes later. Because right, that's it. Put the phone down. Said, Azerbaijan is on board. And I went, Okay, and even Morris said, right, that's it. We are not talking Eurovision.
Oid speisialta, oid speisialta. Tonight, Europe comes to the dock of Dublin Bay.
I remember talking to him after it, and he wasn't shaky or there was nothing. He was just, he was delighted with it. He loved being out there, and he would have done that every week if he could do it.
Jerry's career was at a high. His ever-increasing listenership figures brought in substantial revenue to RTE, and TV offers were coming in. At home, his growing family and Maura were keeping his feet on the ground.
Jerry and Maura were great fun to go out with. Wonderful company. They were cut out for each other. There was just a great love there. Maura had wonderful jokes and stories and would normally take over. And instead of him being the performer, the storyteller, the joker, Jerry would always sit back.
Myself and Mrs. Ryan tried out that chocolate stuff that you paint on. That's stupid.
Is it?
Yeah.
I'd be worried about leaving stains on the lovely linen sheets.
Wrecking the bed. It sounds better than it is.
You probably have to do that in the garden.
She understood show business. She understood how it plays on the ego. And, you know, you almost want, for anybody in broadcasting, when they come home, there should be a sign on the door that says, please leave your ego outside. And she managed that very well for him.
He found her fascinating. What she thought, what she did, what she was wearing. And, of course, he brought that to the airways as well and shared it on numerous occasions.
But there I was with a cup of tea, because it was only half a bottle of Carlsberg in the house last night, and I was trying to suck up to the wife by giving that to her.
What kind of work and preparation? Jerry did no work. Jerry did no preparation. He just arrived in late often. Always had some kind of an Alka-Seltzer or whatever the hell was lying around the desk. And off he went, just plugged himself in. I mean, like, he didn't think of anything he was going to say. It just was there, and that was the beauty of it. God, I'd be very disappointed if he had done work for it.
I would write the brief. I handed it to him when I went into the studio. He never glanced over it until, you know, he put up the fader, the mic would go live, and he would read literally the opening paragraph, and that would be the end. Then we go off and tangents.
You'd be telling me that the Pope's nose isn't a turkey's willy.
The Pope's nose isn't a turkey's willy.
It is
turkey. It's his neck. It's got a bone in it.
No, it hasn't.
There's no willy in the world that has a bone in it.
Well, it depends on what you do to it.
I suppose. Michael, good morning.
I think one of the reasons that Jerry built an audience as quickly as he did in daytime radio was his experience of life was very similar to his audience's experience of life.
The day-to-day drudgery he brought to air, that domesticity.
As usual, the Ryans will be hitting Walt Disney World, and I'm hoping to purchase a longer video so that we don't have to keep rewinding this.
He had the confidence that he could breeze into studio and he could talk about what he saw that morning, what someone said to him that morning, what his kids said to him, what the kids were doing for homework last night.
Everyone felt they knew him because he shared so much of his life. And I think he was the first person to do that.
And he was bringing it to the airwaves, obviously exaggerating most of it.
Because I'm a hypochondriac, I had a colonoscopy.
Yes.
And this fellow wearing a pinstripe suit, he said, I'm going to stick my hand, not my finger, up your anus. I said, what are you going to do? And he says, I'm going to laugh.
Jerry was one of the best spoofers I've ever met in my life. Anybody who knew Jerry knew he was the biggest and best spoofer. We knew. And by the way, we didn't say that as a criticism. We just, it was part of his entertainment value.
Isn't there a little camera thing that came up?
Yes. I subsequently discovered that.
Yes.
That's what it's about. You can't do that kind of stuff without spoofing. Don't be ridiculous.
We are all developed from the female clitoris.
Oh,
not a rib
that?
Taken. That's true.
But just the chromosomes. Yeah. But I mean, not your whole body.
Not just the penis, obviously. Look.
Not your whole body. I mean, you're kind of suggesting that before there was apes, there was a clitoris.
I don't think he was sex obsessed. He just had a very healthy interest in women. Like,
he knew an incredible amount about women. He wasn't afraid to talk about every aspect of the female celebration, from the orgasm to parts of your body to satisfying your man.
Like, he would talk about masturbation, which literally, you know, didn't even happen in Ireland before Jerry Ryan.
Both of you behave. It goes in under your bottom and out again.
Yeah,
into
your bottom and out again.
Really, what time is this going up?
Please,
and then the top part.
Turn down the air conditioning.
We noticed that we were actually getting away with quite a lot. Like, we were saying stuff that you couldn't say in other programmes. And you couldn't say on that programme either. Like, you weren't supposed to.
I think the management just did not know what to make of him. You know, they were delighted. He was obviously bringing an audience and they could charge more for their ads and all that. But they were terrified of him as well. Like, and the funny thing is, they needn't have been. He knew how far he could push it.
I have a full head of hair.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good.
And I have an enormous penis.
Okay, so...
Management and RT were very concerned at the repeated use of the word penis. So a senior management person asked to meet me and he said Jerry was using the word repeatedly on air and for no particular reason. And so I came back and I conveyed management's concern to Jerry. And I said, I've got to go back and talk to my bosses about this. So we came up with a kind of thing, which was that we wouldn't mention the word penis during the summer months or the school midterm breaks. That seemed to go down quite well.
Oh, here's the Director General, and he's just... Get out. You've gone too far this time.
You're sacked. You're fired.
Jerry Ryan was to become the most listened to radio presenter in Ireland.
I'd like to hear them explain how you get to a point in your...
Independent radio kept knocking, and in 1997, Radio Ireland offered Jerry a deal which he couldn't ignore.
Jerry was offered silly money to go to some of the other stations. He was a commercial cash cow. In crude money terms, 2FM was probably generating 12 or 13 million euro profit for RTE, large amount of it centred around Jerry.
Oh, it would have devastated RTE and in particular 2FM. I mean, Jerry was 2FM in straight financial terms. He had 3 hours of prime time. That's where the money was made. But RTE was very smart and they moved at the right time to close out Jerry. In fact, one of the senior managers in RTE came round to Jerry's house with a large cheque and said, look, as a gesture of goodwill, we really want you to stay. Here's a big cheque. And that's what sealed the deal.
Now, he was born in Clontarf, but he should have been born in Downton Abbey. I think he thought he was born in Downton Abbey.
He couldn't spend a tenner if there was 100 quid to be spent. He liked eating in very, very expensive restaurants. He liked ordering ridiculous bottles of wine.
He loved talking about money. He loved talking about how much money he had. But I don't think I have ever sat down and had lunch with him where he didn't pay for everything.
He wasn't good with money. He liked having it, but the minute he had it, it was gone.
There's no way he would want to go down to Dromoland Castle by road if there was a helicopter to take him.
Yeah, but that's a part of him I didn't like. And I never got used to it, and I used to tell him it was, you know, just that cool people didn't do that.
The public Jerry and the private Jerry were not miles apart. He liked to be seen as kind of being this everyman Egypt, but there was way more to him than that. He loved rubbing shoulders with very wealthy people. But it was power, I think, above celebrity. And actually, you wouldn't find him at the table afterwards with Westlife. He would be at the table afterwards with the promoters because they were the people who wielded the power. He was more fascinated by that.
Jerry's love of the high life and his ability to charm the rich and famous were the perfect ingredients for his next TV series, Ryan Confidential.
Jerry's wheelhouse really was a nice dinner table with nice food and a nice drink, with good company, smart people, people who could talk, and him as the ringmaster.
You don't give a shite what anybody thinks about
you.
No,
I don't.
Why?
Why should I care?
It's not that moralistic a fucking world where I'm not going to get the next gig because I say fuck or is it not?
No.
Even though Ryan Confidential was a lot of the times in terms of language and discourse, over the top, it was a hit because you really felt you were sitting at that table with them. You felt you were the person in the middle between Jerry and the guest.
How do you survive an experience like that with you then?
It's just business.
You know, I don't regret anything in my life.
I've got two articulated trucks of things I regret. I'm not
saying what happened over there. You could develop a conversation and you could allow it go somewhere that wasn't in the brief. And that format allowed him to do that.
You're you're just one run of the mill is.
So, from the outside perspective, it looks aggressive because of the way you work. In the hard-ass, cold face of an SS work.
He would be annoyed when it didn't work. And he met Gordon Ramsay once, and he would constantly tell you about, you know, how bad that was, you know? Because Gordon Ramsay wasn't paying enough respect to what they were trying to do.
You're a pussycat. You're a big Dulux dog. So, it's aggressive.
But I can call you a... if I want to!
Have you had your heart checked recently?
In March 2008, after 26 years of marriage, Jerry announced that he and Maura were to separate.
I think he was devastated. I know he was devastated. You know, if the happiest times of his life were when he and Maura and the children were in the fullness of their family existence, I'd say the darkest time of his life was after he split up.
Every time you met him, there was a great heaviness about him. He naturally was a man who wanted to be in the family home.
He was drifting on his own. It didn't suit him not being at home, you know?
Large numbers of viewers have been following the twists and turns of the economic crisis in RTE, but the station itself hasn't been immune to falling revenues.
When the crash came and RTE had to be seen to slash and burn, particularly the high salaries, and Jerry's was particularly high. Unfortunately, Jerry's own financial situation was extremely difficult at that time because he was going through a separation and the money troubles were just drowning him.
1857-15-922, the Ryan Loan.
Ryan Loan.
The Ryan Loan, which is giant, by the way.
Ryan Loan.
As the country fell into an economic depression and people's jobs and homes were on the line, RTE's big earners were asked to take a pay cut, but Gerry dug in and refused.
He very foolishly decided to start saying, "I'm worth it." Well, that wasn't the public mood.
There were times when people were meant to tighten belts and be nicer to everybody else, and that I think there was a certain amount of arrogance that probably didn't do him any good.
After a lot of pressure from both inside and outside RTE, Gerry's hand was forced, and eventually he accepted a pay cut.
I totally get why people were not sympathetic to Gerry's point of view. All I can say is I was there. He was really, really struggling, and he was deeply unhappy, and he was not managing at all well. He wasn't in good shape. He was drinking too much. He was eating all the wrong foods. He wasn't exercising. He was stressed beyond belief.
He got into the habit of coming round here, and you could feel the tension in him. He wouldn't go to bed till 2 or 3 in the morning. He had to be up at 6 or 7 o'clock. And I used to say to him, "Would you go home, for Christ's sake?" And he didn't seem able to judge that. He was wearing himself out, because he'd come on in the morning and he'd be terrific, but he paid a price for it, you know, took its toll.
Operation Transformation hit the screens in 2008, and it became a ratings winner for Gerry Ryan.
This is Operation Transformation.
Like, it was so tiny when it started off, but it was an instant hit. And Gerry was fantastic, because he was very honest. He struggled with weight himself. So when he was standing by the scales with someone, they all loved him. They knew Gerry was on their side.
By God, you've been successful. You have lost 7 pounds. What about that? What about that? Is that fantastic?
When he moved into Leeson Street, myself and Pat Kenny went down for a few drinks one evening, and he was showing us the house, which he was renting. But the main thing he showed us was a new gym in the house. His new gym, all the equipment, I think the plastic was still over the exercise bike and the rowing machine and the weights. And he was determined to spend more time. But his lifestyle, his daily routine even, didn't facilitate the gym.
Gerry's personal life was to draw the attention of the media once again when he began a relationship with the former South African ambassador, Melanie Verwoerd.
I never really figured out, and I never really spoke to him about how they met. And, you know, I would have respected where they were, and that's as far as I went with them, because I was in that position, as you can perhaps imagine, where, you know, I was very close to the children and Maura, and by the same token, I wanted to respect what he was doing and where he was with his life.
Gerry was very intrigued by Melanie and her previous career as an ambassador. And in many ways, I was happy for him, because he needed somebody to look after him. And she came along at that moment, and in a different kind of way, they had a meaningful relationship.
It had always been Gerry's dream to become the host of The Late Late Show. In 2009, Gerry stood in for Pat Kenny, albeit for one night only.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. What a fantastic atmosphere in here tonight. And I have to admit, the mouth is dry and just a tiny bit odd to find myself standing in here for Pat tonight and welcoming you to the big one, The Late Late Show.
He was really keen to get The Late Late Show. And in one sense, he was ideal for it in terms of his age, his experience, his profile.
Well, tell me a little about yourself. Come on. Tell me what you were like when you were 17. I was living in Clontarf. I had hair down to here, and I was an idiot.
Gay used to come here with us, and he would interrogate him and study that show and dissect it, how it was done. And he felt that he was born for that. He really did.
After much hype as to who would replace Pat Kenny, the mantle was passed to Ryan Tuberty.
He was initially very disappointed he didn't get it.
That's my chair!
That's showbiz. He knew that. He's from a showbiz family.
That's a real Jerry Ryan question.
He taught me everything.
Whether he deserved it or not, I don't know enough about RTE to know, but the powers that be didn't agree, so he was devastated over that. He really was.
Good morning, RTE Radio 1. It's Friday, the 30th of April at 7 o'clock, and this is Morning Ireland.
I remember my wife was put directly through to me on a landline, and she said, I've got news about Jerry. And I said, yeah, what is it? And all I heard was heart attack. And I said, oh, God, where is he? Where is he? What hospital is he in? And she said, no, man, he had a heart attack. He's gone. He's dead. That was very tough. I'd lost my brother. And that was horrible. And then I thought about his children, then I thought about the family.
Word came in very early into 2FM. People were shocked, you know? People were horrified, it was.
And then the world changed, and not for the better, yeah.
I want to thank his bigger family, all his listeners. You were so important to him, and over these days, it's so beautiful to see how important he was to you. You were the reason he got up every morning. When the little red light went on in studio, he lit up, and he was yours.
Now, since Friday's inquest into the death of the broadcaster Jerry Ryan, many newspapers have carried extensive coverage of the issues raised, the dangers of cocaine use, and its easy availability.
I was called into the office of my boss. He said to me, oh, they found traces of drugs in his blood. And I cried.
Really, I was shocked, but I was really sad as well. The brilliant broadcaster he was, I just felt I didn't want it tarnished by this because it didn't reflect him as a person.
I was aware that Jerry had been using cocaine in the past. As far as I was concerned, he had told me that he wasn't using anymore.
Was I shocked that there was drug usage? No, of course I wasn't. The boom years in Ireland had seen an enormous uptake in cocaine usage. So I wasn't completely surprised, but I didn't know about it.
Was it easy for the family? No, no. But like a lot of things, you just have to take it on the chin and move on and remember the Jerry that we all knew and loved.
You've always been here with me.
Jerry was, unquestionably, the most naturally gifted broadcaster of my generation.
He had this gift, the way he would say something, funnier than anybody I've ever met in my life.
The brightest, the boldest, the bravest, Jerry was afraid of nobody, but he was reverential, especially to his listeners.
He understood better than almost anybody else the possibilities of radio.
He was like Ronaldo in a radio studio. You know, he could do things that no one else could do.
More or less invented a genre in Irish radio. I mean, nobody's done it better.
And when we pass each other once again.
He was the perfect vessel to reflect the growing up of the country.
He opened up discussion on everything from sexuality to domestic abuse, and he opened it up in a different way because he let the public come on air and discuss it.
He gave a voice to people that were silenced and stigmatized.
The punters felt it and it responded to it, and that's what made him a great broadcaster.
We are too fast.
His legacy is his family. His legacy are his children. And, you know, I'm pretty sure if he was sitting here having, you know, the Jerry Ryan whiskey with us, that's what he would say.